In control. Welcome to worship. This is the second Sunday in July, and we have a wonderful worship time together to celebrate Jesus' resurrection. All right, let's stand together and sing our processional hymn number 98, Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing. Or you can just have a seat, either way. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we thank you this morning that we might come into your presence, that we might worship you, because you are a great God. You're a good God. You're the creator and maker of all the universe. Job had nothing to say to you when you said, when you asked him, where were you when I created the heavens and the earth and the mountains and the oceans and all the vegetation and all the plant life and all the animal life and all life. Job had nothing to say because he was in the presence of an awesome God. Help us, Lord, to be humbled in the same way, to acknowledge you as a superior being. You are deity. You are way beyond any of us here. Help us, Lord, to admit that we are arrogant people, we are prideful people, we are selfish people, and we want to come before you and confess our sin before you. Help us, Lord, to acknowledge your Son, Jesus Christ, who paid the price to forgive us all our sins, past, present, and future. We thank you, Lord, that as we confess our sins before you, that you will forgive us our sins and give us a clean slate, that we can be pure in your sight, we can be holy in your sight, because of what Christ did on the cross for us. We want to praise you this morning, acknowledge you, and give you all the adoration and honor that you deserve. Help us, Lord, to submit ourselves, to humble ourselves in our hearts, and acknowledge you as the supreme being, the supreme commander, our Lord, our Master, our Savior. Now we pray that you would help us, through your Holy Spirit, to worship you in spirit and in truth. And now we pray as Jesus taught. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come,
Thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Please be seated. This is Communion Sunday. We have they also call it the Lord's Supper, and this is one of the ordinances that our church honors. And I'm going to say it now so I don't have to say it later, okay? If you're not a believer in Christ, if you have not accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, we welcome you to worship with us, but please do not participate in our worship, in our communion service, okay? That's for believers who have been baptized by water, who have acknowledged that they're a Christian, acknowledge that Jesus is their personal Lord and Savior, okay? I'll say that now, then I'll have to repeat it later, okay? All right, now we're going to sing a song on page 405, and this is to paint a picture of what communion is all about.
Stands a confession of faith, which is stated in the Apostles' Creed. Let us confess our faith together. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth,
and in Jesus Christ, His Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day He rose from the dead, and ascended into heaven, and sitting at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence He shall come to judge the quicks and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Please be seated.
Not Hawaii. He mentioned last week that his daughter, she's in the regionals for a track meet up in Eugene, Oregon, okay? So pray for, the race is over, it's yesterday, okay? Pray that they'll have a safe journey back, and I'm sure he'll report what God has been doing in his life, okay? We're going to have communion today, so I re-announce, if you're not baptized or you haven't received Christ, then please just observe, okay, what we're going to be doing today. All right, let's pray. Make sure you're clear with God, okay? If you have not, if there's something you have against a brother or sister in Christ or your parents or something like that and you haven't fixed it up yet, then maybe abstain for today, okay? Make sure everything's right with everybody before you come to God, all right? Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you this morning that we might come together to remember your life and death and resurrection. Help us, Lord, to grasp more of the significance of what communion is and why you have ordered us to have this Last Supper on a regular basis so that we might focus on you and all the things that you have done to give us salvation and eternal life. Please forgive us our sins. Please help us to listen to the promptings of your Holy Spirit as he convicts us of sin. Please forgive us, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I hope you were praying while I was praying. All right? Because we're going to ask the ushers to come forward right now. That night, the Lord, the same night which he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Please wait until we all have the elements, and then we'll share it together.
Let us pray. praise God together on our knees. When I fall on my knees with my face to the rising sun, oh Lord, have mercy.
This wafer represents Christ's real physical body, who was born, lived 33 years or so, was tried, what, six times? 4 to 6 times, was beaten, suffered, bruised, spit upon, shamed, humiliated, took rape, put off his clothes, and was on a cross, huh? And he died. He suffered on the cross. And he was buried, and his body was broken for our sakes. He paid the penalty for our sins. All right? And that's what this represents. Let's stand together and partake of the wafer of the bread. Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for sending your Son, Jesus Christ, to become one of us human beings here on earth. And he went through all the things that we went through, and he knows how it feels to be tempted. He knows how it feels to see the consequences of sin all around, that we have a fallen world, and there's much evil going on. Most importantly, Lord, that people rejected you. And we thank you, Lord, that Jesus died so that we don't have to reject you and you don't have to reject us. Because of Jesus' blood, it covers all our sins, all our transgressions, all our iniquities, all our unlawfulness, all our selfishness. We thank you, Lord, for Jesus dying on the cross for us, that we might have salvation. Thank you, Lord, for your great love for us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Please be seated. And after the same manner, also, Jesus took the cup. And when he had supped, he said, "This cup is the new testament of my blood. Do this as often as you drink. Drink it in remembrance of me."
And live forever. taste the living water and never thirst again. Come just as you are, hear the Spirit call. Come just as you are, come and see, come receive, come and live
We remember Christ's first coming, when he came and lived and died and rose again. This is also a time to remember his second coming. That in the scriptures, Jesus will be coming again and to restore his creation. It'll be a recreation. We'll have a new a new heaven, a new earth, a new Jerusalem. We will. If you're a believer, you will have a new body, a glorified body, a body just like Jesus had, okay? And we want to celebrate the time that all evil will be gone, all sin will be gone, all pain will be gone, all suffering will be gone, all trials and tribulation will be gone when Jesus comes back again. So that's part of the other half of this communion service that we have, to remember Christ and his coming again. All right? Let's stand together and remember Christ. Heavenly Father, you've had your Son Jesus shed his blood that we might have newness of life, that we might celebrate life, no matter what's happening on this world that's gone wrong, that in our hearts we have new life. You created a new spirit within us, and it's your spirit, and your Holy Spirit is residing in our hearts. Help us, Lord, to be your testimony, to be your witness, to share your gospel with those around who aren't as fortunate as we, to hear the gospel, to have an opportunity to receive Christ as our personal Lord and Savior, to be indwelt by your Holy Spirit, to have you as our Heavenly Father, because we are your children. We are children of God. Thank you for the blessings. Help us, Lord, to have new hope and renewed vigor to share your message with those around. And we look forward to one of these days when we get to be with you in heaven. And thank you, Lord, for preparing a place for us and getting everything ready when we leave this earth. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Please be seated. Thank you, sir. We're going to sing a song again, okay? The name of the song is called In Remembrance of Me, okay? I think I'm going to add a little visual effect. If it's a little too graphic for you, just close your eyes, all right? Inside your bulletin, you have the words, all right? So you're welcome to sing along. If you're multitask, you can sing and watch at the same time, all right? And I hope this adds to your communion experience.
spread.
Sing along if you like.
In remembrance of me, drink this wine. In remembrance of me, pray for the time when God's own will is done. In remembrance of me, heal the sick. In remembrance of me, feed the poor. In remembrance of me, open the door and let your brother in. Yes.
Take out our offerings and tithes and gifts that you have prepared for God, giving this money for the to the house of God. Ushers, would you help us on that? Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for your great love and unspeakable love, never-ending love, and unconditional love that you have for us. In Romans 8, you mentioned that
In Romans 5:8, you mentioned that you loved us even while we were yet sinners. That's how powerful your love is. Thank you, Lord, for your blessings. Please accept these gifts as our obedience to you and a token of our love. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Our young adult college choir will be singing a song that is quite simple. And if you love the Lord, you would want to trust him. All right? Put your trust in God, not in anything else. And that you would want to obey him, that you will follow his ways, that you would follow Christ. The song is called Trust and Obey.
Trust in you and do what you say.
Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, we pray that your message would come out today. We pray for your servant who's presenting this message. We pray for the hearts that are here, that you would prepare their hearts for the leading of your Holy Spirit, that your Holy Spirit would bring to memory the things that they need to know and the things that you're presenting today. Thank you, Lord. May you get all the glory and praise. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Excuse me if things are a little unorthodox. I'm going to ask for two volunteers. Okay, one volunteer with a stopwatch, with second hand and something like that. Somebody want to volunteer to keep time for me? Jackie, have one? Okay, just you don't have to get up or anything else like that. Okay. Or timer, whatever it is. Okay. But don't time me. We're going to time someone else. The second volunteer we're going to time, okay? I need somebody who's willing to be humiliated. I need somebody to do something physical. It won't hurt you, but it might be painful. Okay? So.
Permanently.
It won't hurt you permanently. No, it won't hurt you at all. It won't hurt you off. It'd just be a little painful, okay? So, could I get a volunteer, please?
Man. All right. We have a volunteer.
Really? Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Either side. Okay, I was hoping for a guy, but it's okay. No, come. Because this will really fit. What I want you to do, come on.
Now she's afraid.
It won't damage you permanently, okay? I've done this before, when I was very small, okay? All right. We're gonna all identify with her, okay? Vicariously, you are up here, okay? All I'm going to ask you to do, are you a follower of Christ?
Yes.
Okay, you know he died on the cross?
Yes.
You know in Matthew 16:24, it says, deny yourself, pick up your cross, and follow me. Okay, so you almost ready, Jackie? Okay, yes. So I'm just going to ask Joycelyn to put her hands like the cross for as long as she can, okay? If you saw the movie, you know, what's that, football one, Giants, fighting the Giants? Facing the Giants, okay? They had this death crawl where the guy's carrying this guy on his back and he's crawling and then crawling and he says, I'm too tired. Oh no, keep going. Don't give up. Give every ounce of strength that you have and do it. And that guy did the impossible, okay? So we're going to ask you to do something, you know, as long as you can, okay? Keep your arms up. Don't give up. It's okay if you want to move your body a little bit, if it's pain gets a little excruciating or not. Just you guys pray for her, okay? All right? As long as you can, okay? Whether it's 2 minutes, 3 minutes, 10 minutes, 20 minutes. I should be done in half an hour. So if you can last by half an hour, that'll be good. Okay? All right. You can pray for her, but concentrate on my words, okay? Let's see how long this lasts. All right. So when you're done, just you can go down. We'll give you a hand. Jackie will tell me how much time it's been. Actually, do you guys want to trade places? No, that's all right. No, that's okay. That's good. Jesus was our substitute. Okay, ready? Get set? Ready? Go. Okay. So that you don't get too distracted, we have an insert for you. Okay? Would you take that out, please? Oh, yeah, it's on the back of that communion thing that you had, right? So my sermon is going to be two parts. The first part is the principle, okay? And we're going to talk about the principle today.
And then if we have time, we'll go into the practical. I'll give you one practical example, okay? In fact, I could have named this sermon Trust and Obey, okay? So all the stuff that the choir was singing about is applicable today. She's good. Okay. I have some of the scripture references here, okay? If you are really interested in this, take out your Bible. Actually, how many of you have a Bible? Could I see your Bible? I mean, with us today, okay? Bible or electronic Bible? Okay, good. Excellent. Okay, take notes for her, okay? All right. Maureen and, yeah. All right. So, thank you. So, I have two Bible verses on top. I have three Bible verses on the bottom in the small print. If you're really interested, go look them up, all right? We're going to have one main passage, James 4, that we base this thing on, all right? So, let's get started. Proverbs 3:5. Who knows that? Go. Trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. And you know verse 6 and all that, okay? Very simple. Trust in the Lord with all your heart, but don't lean on your own understanding. That's the temptation. If I understand it, I'll do it. If I don't understand it, I'm not going to do it. Why should I do that? Okay? That's where trust comes in. Do you trust God? Okay? Joyce Lynn trusts me, all right? She volunteered. She knew I'm going to push her off the cliff or something like that. Okay? All right, you're still there. Good. Is it painful yet? Just uncomfortable. Okay. Let's see the pain on her face later. Okay. All right. Principle, good principle, right? Trust in the Lord. You don't have to understand what God's doing. Look through all the Old Testament. Okay, Joshua, Jericho, Abraham, Mount Moriah, all those people, they just went by faith. They didn't understand it. Even Job, we've been studying Job in Sunday school. He didn't understand anything. Why am I suffering? And did God give him an answer at the end? No. He just says, were you there when I created the heavens and earth? Were you there when I created the sea? Were you there when I created the mountains? Were you there when I created all plant life and all human life and all animal life? Were you there? And he just goes through in those last few chapters and says, I am God. Who are you? All right, who am I? That's an important principle. Okay. The next verse, the set of verses, is in Isaiah 55, 8 and 9. Okay. Do you guys know this one? For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, declares the Lord. For as high as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts higher than your thoughts. You cannot understand God, because his ways are way higher than us. Okay? Our puny, finite minds cannot understand what God is doing. Okay? He can make it so simple that a little child can understand how to receive Christ and go to heaven. But he can make it so complicated that these guys at the seminary, these theologians, they fight over, well, are you predestined and you have no choice? Or do you have a choice? Or did God elect you? And and they're fighting over all these things, okay? They, you know, the Arminians here, Calvin's over here, and they're just, it's so complicated, they can study for 4, 8, 12 years, get all these doctorates, and still be confused. I have some friends that have went to seminary, and they hardly believe in God anymore because they got so messed up by talking about who wrote the Pauline letters and who did this and who that, and they analyze everything using their puny human minds. They profess themselves to be wise, but they are fools. All right? Okay, so that's it. You got the principle of those two things? Okay. Trust in God. Don't lean on your own understanding. God's ways are infinitely higher than our ways. Okay. Exponentially higher than our ways. Now, we're ready to go. Okay, we set the stage for the scripture.
James chapter 4, verses 6 and 7. Let me read it to you in the ESV, English Standard Version. God opposes the proud, but gives grace to the humble. Submit yourselves, therefore, to God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Simple. Good? I'll read it again. God opposes the proud, but gives grace to the humble. Submit yourselves, therefore, to God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. All right, let's fill out the worksheet. Number one, don't be proud. Simple, okay? Otherwise, you have a little triangle there to add some extra points. Otherwise, God will be against you. God will be against you. God opposes the proud. All right. Do you want to be against God? Yay! Ouch. Does it hurt? Jackie. Six minutes and 30 seconds. Oh, okay. Thank you. Sometimes to be a witness for God, it gets painful, okay? Jesus endured great pain, going through all those trials at midnight, going all the beatings and the 39 lashes, and the, if you saw the Passion of the Christ, you see they put stuff on the whip, you know, barb, you know, metal things, glass things, and all that. And you saw all the blood all over the floor. And what touched me later is that in the movie, Pilate's wife brought down some towels to the mother and the women, and they soaked up all the blood, soaked up Jesus' precious blood, okay? So we're going to talk about some things today that are not easy. Thank you, Joycelyn, okay? Not easy. And it might be painful, but it won't hurt you permanently. In fact, it will bless you. All right? So here's the principles, and we'll write down four things, and hopefully we'll have time at the end for a little story. All right? To help you to have a blessed life. All right? That's what God wants. He wants to bless you. He doesn't want to curse you. But our choices might curse ourselves. All right? Here we go. Don't be proud, because God will be against you. You cannot fight God. All right? You don't want to be an enemy of God. You want to be a friend of God. All right? Another side point is that if you're proud, don't expect any grace. Don't expect grace. Sometimes we presume that God will be gracious to us. He'll forgive us. We'll have a good life no matter what I do, no matter what choices I make. But sometimes, you know, grace is something that you don't deserve, all right? So don't expect grace. The scripture says, but God gives grace to the humble, okay? If you're humble, if you're willing to be humiliated, all right? Thank you again, Joycelyn, okay? If you're willing to be humiliated, then God might grant you his grace. He gives grace to the humble, but he opposes the proud. That means if you think you know better than God, watch out, okay? His ways are higher than our ways. His thoughts are higher than our thoughts, just as is the heavens above the earth. If you think you know it all, if you think you know how to invest better than God, if you think you know how to run your family better than God, if you think you can live your life by your choices, you know, a lot of things. We don't have time to go into everything, okay? Oh, I'm dating this non-Christian, all right? It doesn't matter, all right? I'll win her or him over later, okay? That's not what the Bible says. You think you know better than what the Bible says? Okay, and we can apply this to any lot of things, okay? Hopefully, if you have a question about something you're doing in life, check with your Sunday school teacher. Check with your fellowship leader. Check with your small group. Check with one of the pastors, okay? To make sure you're making the right decisions, all right? Okay. Number two, submit to God, okay? Submit to God, because he's deity. He knows everything. He created us. He knows how we tick. He knows our strengths and weaknesses. He knows our susceptibilities, our weaknesses. And he knows how to protect you from the evil one and this world, okay? The word submit is hupo eko, okay? Hupo means under, eiko means yield. So you're yielding under God's will, okay? That's the idea. Submitting means that you're going under and you're, you know, you're humbling yourself and you're under God's protection or authority or umbrella. Another word for submit would be to retire, not that kind of retire, but you know, to withdraw, to move back, okay? To back off from what you want and let God do what he wants. To let go of what we want so that God can do. Jesus prayed in Gethsemane, you know, not my will, but thy will be done. All right, whatever you want and whatever manner you want to do it, okay? The method of saving the world is still up to you, okay? So same thing for you, whether you're dating life or whether you're making a living or planning for your family or whatever, okay? Planning for your financial investments. Okay, principle three, resist the devil, okay? Because the devil has bad things in store for you. God has good things in store for you. The word resist in Greek is antihistamine. Sounds like a drug. All right, if you have allergies or something, you know. But actually, I think that we do use it, okay? The anti means against, and the histami, it means to cause to stand, okay? So these antihistamines that we take are meant to go against these germs or these things that are making you runny nose, watery eyes, and all the other stuff, the things that you kind of, all right? So we can check with the pharmacist and stuff, okay, what antihistamine does, okay? But the biblical word means to withstand, means to oppose, all right? So we need to oppose the devil. Okay, first three down, one more to go. We might get out early. Okay. The problem with us is that we do naturally what's opposite from what the Bible says. Okay? The Bible says, submit to God. Resist the devil. What do? Resist God. Submit to the devil. That's what temptation is all about. Okay? The things that you get tempted to do, the things that you get tempted to eat, the things that you get tempted to watch, the things that you get tempted to listen to, okay, in the office, the person that compliments you and kisses up to you or, you know, does all kind of nitty, you listen to that person, but at home, you don't listen to your wife or your husband or your mother or your father because it is not pleasing to the ear. We listen to what pleases us, okay? We like the things that please us. And when things get tough and we have to struggle through it and we have to suffer a little bit, okay, no permanent damage, but it's just very painful, very awkward, we don't like that, okay? The song the choir sang, trust and obey, all right? God leads us. Jesus is leading us, all right? But the question is, do we follow, okay? Jesus is leading us every day, every moment of the day. But do we follow his lead or we take off on our own path? This is what I want to do today, okay? Okay. I don't want to give any money to this poor person, okay? I don't want to honor my parents today because they did a terrible job. They swore at me and they made me eat this stuff I didn't like to eat and things like that, okay? We have a tendency to resist God, who is good, and submit to the devil, who is bad. He wants to destroy you. He wants to mess you up. And yet, because he's so subtle and so enticing, we get seduced by the things that Satan puts in front of us. You get the picture? All right. So you know what you're seduced by. You know what you're enticed by. You know what you're tempted by. Okay? Maybe jot down one of those two things on the bottom of your sheet. Okay? And when you give in to that, you're submitting to
the devil. Okay? You're not submitting to God. You're resisting God. When you submit to the devil, you're resisting God. Okay? You've become an enemy of God for that time. All right? This is the warning that God gives us. Okay? Number four on your notes. And we're almost done. Okay? Number four. Choose your Lord. Thank you, Sammy. Renee's so happy. She guessed it already. Okay. Choose who's your Lord. All right? Either you're a servant of righteousness or you're a servant of unrighteousness. Either you're following Christ or you're following the devil by your decisions, by who you choose. Joshua 24:5 says, choose you this day whom you will serve. Okay. You have a choice this day. Joshua, okay. You have a daily choice, but you have a lifelong choice too. All right? Choose you this day whom you will follow, Jesus or the devil. Matthew 6:24 says, no man can serve two masters. That's the first part. Okay. You call yourself Christians? Good. Do you call yourself Satanists when you're devil people, when you do things bad? Okay. You need to choose. You can't serve two masters. You become double-minded. That's the next verse. Okay. And I didn't make a typo there. Matthew 6:24 at the end, it says, you cannot serve God and mammon. You cannot serve God and money. You cannot serve God and the things of this world. Okay. You have to choose. Number four. Choose your Lord and Master, your sensei, your sifu, all right? Your mentor. Is your master the devil or is your master the Son of God, the Holy One, the one sent to redeem you? Okay? Someone said, well, either Jesus is Lord of all, or he's not Lord at all. All right? You need to give him every area of your life. You need to be constantly growing. All right? Submit to the Lordship of Jesus Christ. Okay? Oh, we got time for a little example. Okay? So you don't have to take any more notes unless you want to. All right. I ran across this in a book. God is generous, GG. Satan is selfish, okay, SS. God wants you to have a blessed life, and blessed means having a supernatural power working for you. Being cursed means having a supernatural power working against you. Got it? Blessing, you have a supernatural power working for you. A curse is having a supernatural power working against you. There was a story, a true story, about this guy named Robert Morris. Okay, we'll just call him Robert. Okay. He was an evangelist, traveling evangelist. You know what an evangelist is? What's an evangelist? No. Well, maybe. He travels doing what? Sharing the gospel. Preaching the gospel to non-believers. Right? Evangelist. Billy Graham. He's an evangelist. He travels around. And if you listen to his message over and over and over again, you're going to get tired of it. Because all he does is say, receive Christ. Receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. Okay? So if you're a growing Christian, I've heard that. I've heard that before. Okay? Because he's not presenting anything new. He's just repackaging. Is it echoing in here? He's repackaging it. Oh, no. All right. So, this traveling evangelist, his sole income was from the love offerings of the churches that he went to. Okay? We had different groups come here and sing, and we'll collect a little offering at the end. We just pour it in the bag and give it to them. All right? So, usually he's like speaks 5 or 6 or 7 or 8 times a month, and that would be enough to support
him and his wife and his family and stuff like that, paying for all the, you know, the food, the housing, the gas, the insurance, all the stuff, you know, whatever, if he had a mortgage or not. So Robert, 1 month, had only one engagement, okay, for the whole month. And he went to this church, okay, and he preached. And at the end, they collected a love offering. At the end of the service, the pastor of the church came up to him. Robert, guess what? We've got an offer, love offering for you. This is the largest love offering we've ever had in the history of our church. So Robert's thinking, oh good, I only have one engagement. I need a lot of money to support this month, right? So the pastor wrote the check, okay, folded it up, put it in an envelope, gave it to him. So, you know, the services ended, he got the check and all that. But he looked in the back, and he saw this guy where Roland is, okay? And Roland, that wasn't his name, but Roland was a missionary, and he had spoken earlier that evening, okay, and shared about his missionary adventures and what's going on in the thing, okay? So he sees that Roland guy, and in his mind, Robert heard God telling him, give him the check. Must be something wrong, okay? So later on, you know, a few seconds later, you hear God, give him the check. So Robert goes, la 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 la, I don't hear you, God. No, I don't want to listen to you. And so, here's God again. He says, give him the check. Trust me. So, Roland, can you come up here, please? Unwilling volunteer, okay? So Robert comes up, he gets the check, he endorses it, folds it, and he says, pastor or whatever, says, thank you, I really appreciated your message today, and I want to give you this. But don't tell anybody I gave it to you. All right. Okay? Good, thank you, thank you. So this guy gave away his monthly income to take care of his family. Okay. So after everybody, you know, they say hello and stuff like that. What they did was after the meeting, they went to the pizza parlor, okay, pizza place. And Robert ends up sitting, there's about 20 people at the place, and, you know, long tables and stuff like that. So Robert's talking to this, across from him is sitting a stranger, well, an acquaintance. He knew him from before, but not really. They don't know each other really well, okay? So they're making small talk. Okay, so Robert's making, and the acquaintance, okay? The acquaintance says, how much did you make tonight? And Robert's shocked. That's personal information. But he was so shocked, he says, oh, I made this much. So the guest, the acquaintance, says, where's the check? He says, he's kind of embarrassed. He says, you know, like, what do you want? My wife has it. Go get it. I want to see it. Okay. So he walks to the end of the table, whispers in his wife's ear, how's the pizza? Good? He comes back, he talks to the guy, he says, she put it in the car. So he's lying. You know? So he says, it's not in the car. How do you know? God told me. And God has a message for you to give to the body of Christ, okay? So, make a long story short, the guy has a piece of paper, folds it in half, gives it to Robert. And he says, this is for you. He opens the check, it's exactly 10 times the amount of the first check that he got, to the penny. All right? And this guy's saying, the message is, if you give generously, God will bless you generously. All right? You got the pick. That's what God wants. All right? So here's the application
for us all, okay? That God must be first. All right? Many scriptures, I have a whole bunch of scriptures from Exodus 13:2. Consecrate to me all that are firstborn. Okay. Exodus 13:12. You shall set apart for the Lord all the first that comes from the womb, all the firstborn. And the idea is that God wants us to give him the first fruits, the firstborn, the first everything. Whatever you get, you give him the first portion. Okay. And the tithe is, we put that 10% in, but it's not exactly that it's the tithe. It's that you want to give him the first of what you've given, all right? So the Old Testament teaches about giving the first 10%, okay? So God is teaching us every day, and the idea is that in Malachi, it says, was it Malachi 3, 9, and 10, 8 and 9, will a man rob God? Yet you have robbed me. But I say to you, how have we robbed you? In your tithes and contributions, okay? The idea is that we need to bring to the house of God the tithes, the offerings to God, okay? Before you do anything else, take the first part, give it to God. Before you pay the government, Caesar, before you pay your mortgage, before you pay your house payments, your car payments, your college loans, whatever you do, give to God the first 10%. Trust him. Follow his lead. Jesus was the tithe that God gave to us. He was a firstborn son. And he gave it to us. Sacrificed it for us. Okay? So here's the principle. Okay? Ending principle. You can be blessed or you can be cursed by what you do. You can give God the first 10%, I mean, this is before giving to the Red Cross or Samaritan Purse or Compassion, any other, you know, homeless things or battered women or slavery or anything like that, you know. What do you call it? Kidnap people, you know, what do you call it? Human trafficking, stuff like that, okay. Give to God first the 10%, and he'll bless the other 90%, okay. You will be blessed by that 90%. Or, if you don't give the 10%, let's say you give 2%, the 98%, or actually the whole 100%, will be cursed. All right? If you don't give God the 10% first, right on top, and he will bless you, the opposite of blessing is a curse. Okay? Supernatural. It was a good quote. Blessing means having a supernatural power working for you.
Okay? Curse is a supernatural power working against you. And that's the principle that God has. All right? Trust him. Obey him. And he will take care of you. Submit to God. Resist the devil's temptations. Don't resist God. Don't fight God. And give in to Satan. Okay? God loves you. He wants the best for you. He wants to bless you. All right, let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for your principles. Help us, Lord, to follow your lead. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We're going to sing a song. We're going to sing verse 2 and verse 3, okay? The song that you have in your sheet,
in the back of your sheet.
We'll sing the second chorus and third verse.
God wants to help you heal the sick, feed the poor, and he wants to give you the finances to do that. Casey? Heavenly Father, we pray that all that we do is to worship you, that we would worship you in the morning, at noon, in the evening, that wherever we are, that we would want to honor you, that we would like to remember you, that we would think of all that you've done for us, that we will heal the sick, we will feed the poor, we will open the door and welcome our brothers and let them into our hearts. Help us, Lord, to trust you and to obey you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Mr. Barry.
This is the time in our worship when we welcome our guests. If you brought somebody today, please introduce them to us at this time. Thank you.
Okay. Slides, please. We welcome Chris, who came back. This is the second time here. All right. And Janet's here. Okay, good. Welcome, Janet. Okay. Different people. And I hope you would let your brother in. Let your sister in. Okay. Let them into your lives. All right. Chris and Cliff went to Foundations class. We still have room for more. All right, so 10 o'clock next Sunday in the John Room, 358, okay, on this floor. Okay, next slide. 358, that's what I said. Okay, today we have Silver AK, and if the weather's good, we'll do a little labor of love. Okay, also, next Sunday we'll have an AK department meeting, all right, to plan out all the good things that will be happening, okay. Next slide talks about what's happening next weekend. On Friday in the evening, we'll be collecting items for our sharing our abundance. It'll be in the cafetorium. Anything that you'd like to share that is in good condition, please bring it so that we can share it with other people, especially if you're not using it and you're not looking at it anymore and all that stuff, okay? So they'll be there Friday night to collect. Also Saturday in the daytime. And next Sunday, we would like to invite all of you after worship to go over to the cafetorium and help us share the abundance, okay? The theme is back to school, so especially if you have some items that are not, you're not using any anymore, like rulers and pencils and binders and things like that, okay, for school people. All right, I think that should do it. All right, have any questions, just check that website and stuff like that.
Let's stand and give God our thanks and praise. Lord God, bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Submit to God, resist the devil. May your life be blessed.